I heard you said that you like Undertale. Well, good, because so do I. And you'll probably see this robe in the video in the next clip where I dance as Toriel at Midwest Fur Fest 2015. During the dance, in which I was invited up to the stage because, well, the DJ was playing an Undertale set of music and just wanted me to join all the fun. So I did. Here's the clip. Now we're back. So, you see me in this again, and probably thinking, oh my god, that was you! I've gotten several of those reactions already. So, yeah, I had a lot of fun there. Got a lot of love, which is with good. But, there's a particular reason why I'm kind of hesitant to say a few things now. That love was a huge booster and something I really needed before what I'm going to explain next. And I'll get back to Undertale, but I want to get to important things first. And I have a script on my screen to try and keep this in as much order as possible, and, well, I haven't done this in a while, so I'm a little out of practice. So, oh, okay, yeah, I told you about Undertale. I'm sorry, I'm kind of rereading a few things, since Ponies with Pockets Productions has been taking up a good portion of my time where I've been trying to edit videos for them and trying to get Undertale videos out while it's hot. Excuse me. Trying to get Undertale videos out while it's hot. Sorry, it was too hot for me to actually say the word hot at first, because they got burned. A little blister. So that's been taking up a good portion of my time, but I want to say a good portion, but that's not exactly the case, since I've gone through a lot of different things recently that kind of pretty much ramped up my social anxiety disorder and clinical depression, and though I know I should not be blaming those and using them as a crutch, they got to a point where it's harder for me to function. And I'll start out by explaining where things went from editing Undertale videos into the lull of infrequent posting on both here, which only got like a couple of videos, one being a best of, a 4 or 5 nights one, and then a video following that best of, which had to do with the most recent Five Nights at Freddy's 1 stream. So forgive me if I'm kind of dancing around the subject, considering it was a little traumatic, and I don't want to use that word lightly because there's a lot of different meanings for it, but I'll start anyways. I started out, of course, just doing Undertale, editing videos, enjoying the streams, having fun, doing a donation drive around Halloween so that Jitters, my boyfriend, my mother, and 2 friends and I could move here. And yes, I am actually here, or wherever should I point, I don't know, in Oregon. And that did not go without a hitch. The thing is, it was a very ridiculous reason we got kicked out of the house. Would you believe we got kicked out, and when I say we, I mean myself, Jitters, my 2 friends, Sin, and Insane. Some of you guys might know them on Tumblr. They're a couple of very fun people and very fun artists, and they're also a couple like Jitters and I, so double dating in an apartment, but double living, actually, and having a quadruple income. It definitely helps with the rent, especially since I'm still looking for a job. And I have been working at it, but again, I've been so out of it that I haven't had much interest to do much of anything because a lot has happened. I'll continue. Okay, so we get kicked out over an argument about food portions and artichoke. Now, my mom, we're not on the best of terms anymore given this fact of events. Trust me, it's a list. It started out at a dinner where we were, excuse me, bump the mic, where Jitters was preparing a small, like, you know, healthy dinner, just a few, like, 5 artichokes in the oven, so that, hey, it's pretty much you're eating artichoke, or not baked. I don't think a good way to describe it. Basically, it's you cut the artichoke in half, and then, of course, you, after it's cooked, of course, you just kind of peel off the meat of the leaves on your teeth, and then it's, well, it's food, it's healthy, it's a nice diet food. Now, this is a usually okay thing, and, well, my mom usually is the type of person who likes to make a lot of food, so there are leftovers for people to have another day, or have for a lunch, or another dinner, because, well, at the time, we were pretty much bottom of the barrel, trying to do things and get them done, make money, and then try and save what we can, save energy, but even my mom was not in the best state of mind, since she was also going through her anxiety, but I'm going to call you out on this. I'm sorry, Mom, you were drinking a lot of alcohol, and an unhealthy amount, and when we tried to address you about it, you would try and have your ways of turning us away. And this exact style of proceeding is where we got into a fight over the size of artichokes, because while I was saying I was already downstairs and there were like maybe a few artichokes left over on the stove, whatever, I was going to want to get a large one because, well, I'm 6 feet tall and I kind of like food. So, of course, this was okay. Everyone is enjoying the dinner and everything, but Mom, I don't want to use her real name because she got me to the point of being so angry at her, and she won't say I'm valid in how I feel as much as she feels valid in how she feels. So, after the fact, we all kept saying, Jack had asked, of course, hey, do you want this artichoke? What size do you want? So it was like, Enzi, Insane's nickname is Enzi. Enzi and I decided, hey, yeah, we want to get a couple of larger ones because they were a couple of larger guys, and it's like, though we could be dieting better, we just kind of want to get a little bit more food, and we didn't have any side made, but anyways, what this eventually led to was my mom, I still feel odd saying that because it puts a weird taste in my mouth. She thought that we were screwing her over on the food portion for the artichoke and giving her the smallest one, and that Jitters, had asked her last what artichoke she had wanted. And, well, in most cases, this would be okay, except for the fact that she believed she was getting the smallest one. And they were all about the same size, and that another thing was she wanted it to be that there was enough, than or more than enough food for everyone, other than just a little artichoke. So what she eventually said in the middle of the argument, which I'll get to, she threw out the artichoke because it's not the food, it's the principle. And the principle I still have yet to understand. Anyways, that was more of the why we had the argument, but how the argument went was I came in, as I usually do, check in on everyone, seeing how they're doing, saying, hey, you feeling all right? How you doing? Is something wrong? Stuff like that. And sorry if I keep looking downward, I'm trying to look at the screen because, hey, out of practice. Anyways, I asked what was up, and she was telling me about there not being enough food or getting the smallest one, and she was upset by this, and that she threw it out. Now, of course, I was getting really annoyed at this point, because prior to this, my mom and Jitty and I have had arguments with my mom. And this is over things like certain things going missing, or something accidentally getting eaten. So, like, say, a can of beans that's gone missing. Jitters and I had looked upstairs, found out there was a can of beans on the other side of the cabinet and where she wasn't looking, and then she kept believing that, hey, did you replace this? No, we just found another can of beans. I looked there, it wasn't there! Word for word, She said that, and she tried to make sure she was right and wasn't wrong. My mom's mentality at the time was, I may not be right, but I'm never wrong. And this lasted for quite a while, and even got jitters into more anxious states of mind, to the point where he would refuse to go upstairs and... Sorry, Jitty, I have to say this. You told me, Jitters, you had to piss in a cup, pretty much, because you were that afraid of her. And no one should have to be afraid of a parent unless it's an abusive parent. Gee, I wonder where she falls in that category. She'll tell you she's in the right and that what she's doing is justified. But, yeah, going back to the argument. Sorry, I keep having to pause because it's trying to process, because it's me trying to process a lot. Okay, that's how it went. I got annoyed. And so I just said, you know what? Okay, fine. I'll go ahead and ask if Jitters wants to come upstairs and make sure everyone knows what's going on. And then I'll make sure my other two friends also come up so we can also settle on making sure everything is okay. Everyone can be happy. Kind of like that nice, like, you know what? You're kind of pissing me off. I'm trying to keep a smile. I'm trying to be friendly. That's how I've always been. I always wanted to be, anyways. So, I bring Jitters up, and so I kind of already got Diane. I'm going to say Diane now because it'll be easier than saying my mom, because mom could be anyone's mom. Diane. Sorry, Diane. I'm not your son anymore. You said so. Diane had decided to get into a yelling match with everyone. Jitters was on his knees, actually saying, please stop yelling, please stop yelling, please stop, why aren't you listening, please calm down, please calm down, please calm down. Exactly like that. And she would be over him, like this, telling him a whole bunch of things I don't remember, because all of it was pretty much her yelling and insulting. So, we proceed to go on from there, where she argues with me, I argue with her, Sin argues with her, and it's like she, Diane, is going way off the wall. So I decide to bring Enzi down, since, like me, he is usually pretty level-headed and likes to try and get things taken apart, settle down, get things understood, and since I know that he, of course, was doing his own thing upstairs and wasn't in the middle of a heated conversation, he'd come in as a neutral party. Well, the issue was that Sin was deciding to also call out Diane on what she was doing and how she was being disrespectful, and how and then Diane, of course, would respond about not being respectful and then being justified. And this would get to a point where when Diane was arguing with Sin and Mike had... Now, Mike, I'm used to using normal names. Mike's a general name. I'm sorry, Enzi. Enzi had seen Diane arguing with Sin and yelling at her, so this got Enzi really ticked off. And calling Diane a few names that, of course, he's... like saying, sorry, I know I shouldn't have, I was angry, stuff like that, he's apologetic for, but basically got in her face and calling her out. We eventually got to a point where Diane decided, after we called her a bad person, not a good person, unlike her mother, she wanted us out of the house the following day. Now understand, this argument was at night. So, of course, we were all nervous as heck, and... she was about as cooperative as a 3-year-old wanting that candy bar you didn't get them at a store. So, 2 hours of sleep later, and this was after I stayed up to make sure she went to bed and wouldn't do anything because I was that paranoid about her. 2 hours of sleep later, you guys getting your stuff ready and getting out of the house? Yeah, she decided to kind of call down and get us out of the house, even though in the area of law... she was more than incorrect on being able to kick us out because we've been staying there long enough to, well, have a residence. And with that, we cannot be booted out of the house unless we leave for an extended time or actually say, hey, we're out because, well, hey, I'm Diane's son and therefore She couldn't kick me out. I'm a resident. If I'm not causing any problems, I don't need to be kicked out. So, in the morning, we decided to start packing up a few things. But, Di, being the person she was, she wouldn't stop and being argumentative, blaming me, blaming my friends for all the stuff that's going on, insulting me, calling me a disappointment, a traitor, not her son. I have no idea who you are, quote-unquote. Who are you to do this? Why weren't you on my side? And there was several other things I can't recall right now that will really piss me off if I actually do go into further detail. But hey, I wanted to call her a lot of things. And I'm trying to keep this video as calm as possible. But, of course, given all the pushing, prodding, yelling, insulting, berating, and plain disrespect of me and my friends, with that all going on, I could not process and I could not respond without trying to get really into her, and I don't mean that like a hit, sorry. Sorry, heart's going all at the moment. I was actually at a point where I was actually crying in my dad's arms when I was able to drop a few things off at his house. Trust me, I was trying to do my best to hold things together, trying to calm her down, Diane. Trying to calm Diane down and saying, calm down. I even said, grow up, because she was being this childish. And I say that, grow up, because we actually had to call cops, or I had to call the cops on my mom 3 times. First time, she was able to get to the door and greet the cops, like saying, hi, how you doing? I'm so sorry about this. Of course, during this whole time, I would like to add, she had been drinking over the course of the night into the day. Later in the day, in the evening, and of course this is separate, she decided to go out and get another box of wine, since I had to keep getting her boxes of wine, hopefully being paid back. I wasn't always paid back. Because I was doing a nice thing. Yeah, feeding an addiction where she would finish a box of wine in 2 days. Francia, Sunset Blush. The popular one. You know, the one I'm talking about, probably. Anyways, second time we called the cops on Diane. She was a bit more aggravated, and at that point, we had gotten to the point of cracking a little bit and showing that mean side she had been giving us, when she just tried blocking our paths, locking the door, closing the garage door on Enzi almost. Second time the cops visited, she was a bit more agitated and more upset. And, of course, the first time we explained everything, and so did she. She left out details that we decided to explain. And, of course, cops said, well, sorry, we can't really do anything unless there's something really serious going on. Second time, of course, my friends and I were in the basement. Dan's in the kitchen, where she usually hung out. And when I say usually hung out, she always tried to strike up conversation because in actuality, Diane is a lonely person who needs help. So anyways, second visit. Even the cop, when that came the first time, he came back a second time, and also came back the third time. Second time, he was saying, well, you guys have any place to go? You can go somewhere, you feel better. And, like, I know this would go a lot easier if everyone was acting like an adult, but your mom right now wasn't acting like an adult. They pretty much called my mom out and saying she was being childish. Third and final time the cops visited, this was after even more yelling and drama, and I don't remember which point in between, I ended up crying in my dad's arms because Diana got me that upset. Actually, let me add on to that real quick. Diane had me in such a panic and trauma that when I was at the house, I'd be like this all over, like trying to eat food or trying to drink a glass. I don't have Parkinson's, but I don't want to insult Parkinson's either, so don't you dare start on that. I'd be pretty much to the point of like saying, yeah, I'm all right. You know, the usual short responses. And trying to, of course, keep the strong face, make sure I can get everything I need out of the house, get over to my dad's or into the moving truck. Because, oh, yeah, another thing. In between, I had a very near and dear friend, ATEMU, boyfriend of TENSHI, You might know these two as Rhythm Render and Wispy, and pardon me if I mess this up since I didn't look ahead, Wispy Winterwind. I'll just say Wispy and Rhythm. They'll be linked below, and I'll have the correct name. I apologize if I messed it up because I didn't realize. Wait, I forgot. So, ATEMU, we had been in contact with on that exact night to get a U-Haul to get our stuff to get out of the house. So, ATEMU flew out of Texas that exact night to meet us at the hotel we eventually stayed at for 2 days out of the house. And ATEMU, mind you, I was the only one with the license currently, and I had to do a lot of moving around, move the car, get the U-Haul, get the hotel, U-Haul, go back and forth. We got the U-Haul, and finally, and ATEMU was able to arrive in, but not until after we got everything out of the house that we could, minus some things that, thankfully, were able to still be transferred. Excuse me. So anyways, we got the U-Haul in between the second and third visit so we can get everything out. At least I believe it's the second and third. So, when we were all panicking to get everything out of the house, Diane kept yelling at us and everything, and when she was, of course, yelling and trying to get in our faces and trying to say things that she would constantly deny later, I called the cops a third time. And this is at the point where I was downstairs in the basement, and Diane was trying to make sure I wasn't calling the cops a third time because she was yelling at me and getting angry at me for calling the cops and saying, "You're trying to send me to the loony bin!" Yeah, gee, I wonder why. If you're yelling at us, threatening us, and trying to kick us out of the house, I wonder why we wouldn't look for some protection. I just really don't like her, as you can probably tell. I tried to do everything I could to make her happy and impress her and always be nice. Because, well, I was the smart, good kid that could do no wrong. And if I did call her out on anything, she would kind of get into a small argument with me, but those were minor ones. And the thing about her is that she was a type you would always have to walk on eggshells and reroute what you're saying if you get that one little word in your sentence wrong. It's like, blah, 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 X. So you mean like, oh, and then you're like, oh, no. Blah, 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 Z. Variables, X, Z, you know what I mean. You have to change things a little bit so she wouldn't get angry. Anyways, the third time, the cops come around. This is when I was on the phone, and she could be heard yelling from upstairs. And, well, of course, I wasn't already in a panic enough as it is. I was just saying, we need someone to come here and be stationed. So we got three cops that came that time, one of which was one of the guys from the first two times. So, basically, I was in a panic, trying to explain things, the cops know that Diane was inside, and thankfully we were finally able to get things outside and on the truck without her constantly getting in our path, yelling at us and insulting us and everything. The cops had thankfully just kind of had her stationed off to the family room. Basically, I'll give you a picture. Let's see the best way to describe this since I'm working in a mirror. I guess is the best way to kind of describe it is that you got the main door, you got a hallway, and then you got the family room. And it's more on this side, but whatever. Family room, and you got the basement right next to the hallway of the entrance. So Diane's thankfully over here, kitchen's over here. We were downstairs, always coming up, and then Diane would be right here in the kitchen. Or in the family room making a comment, because we'd be trying to get everything out the main door, into the truck, or into the garage, which was also next to the basement door, conveniently placed between the family room and the kitchen. And I might add, what kind of led to this was the amount of hysterics that Diane had, and yelling, even outside, and calling me out, and hitting my car on the window and the windshield with the intent of, I don't know, freaking me out, causing damage. It's all a matter of trying to figure out what she was saying between, "How could you? How could you? How could you?" drunkenly being stated. We constantly told her she needed help. She knew she needed help. We were going to be coming to Oregon all together so that we can all, of course, get some, like, psychological help, because who doesn't need help nowadays? So anyways, the cops got her stationed off. We got things out of the way. We got everything out of the house after several hours of interruptions in an hour. We got everything out in an hour. That last hour that the cops were there, where they were able to tell that she was getting worse and getting more loud and crying more loudly. And one of the things that I kept catching is that, would you believe if your son did this to you, how would you do this? How would you feel if your son did this to you? Or would you believe if your son did this to you? Diane is the type of person to blame someone else before she blames herself. And of course, she was blaming me for me being kicked out. Basically, I'm kicking you out because of you. That's basically what she was saying. And she was, of course, insulting my friends, called Sin a fat pig, fat cow, whatever. Called Insane a dirty man who's never worked in his life, despite the fact that he has worked. You know, basically, Diane was throwing out every little childish insult that she could just to make herself feel justified. Because it's not the food, it's the principle. Yeah, anyways. Cops got her stationed out. We got everything out in an hour. And at one point in between, Diane was talking about how I needed to throw out the box spring that we couldn't get upstairs for Sin and Enzi. It's a box spring. Throw out the box spring! Throw out the box spring! And even when I was talking to the cop that even let me know battery did occur and I could get her arrested for it, when the cop said, please go back inside, please go back inside, she just decided, right when she's about to close the door, no! Just a little childish no. And of course the cop was like, what'd you say? And it didn't go any further, but Diane, I actually had you in a spot where I could have you arrested, put you through court for however fucking long it took before you could actually understand how fucking stupid you were. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said stupid. Ignorant is the better word. But because you were hitting me on my way out and slapping me on the both front and back, that qualified as battery, and trust me, we have plenty of video and audio to support what we're talking about. And while I was told to let this rest, I don't feel comfortable putting that behind me unless the rest of you know why I have been the way I have been and where things have been going. And maybe this way I can actually raise enough of a stink so that once Diane gets to wherever she's settled, somewhere else in the States, she can actually realize, oh, I fucked up. I need to get help. I need to stop blaming everything and everyone else. Oh, by the way, you know what? While we're on the subject, I'm going to pull up the texts that Diane had sent me. Okay. Ugh. Still having in there's mom. Okay, let's see if I can cover this correctly. See if you can see this. Okay, I'll read it out for you. So you know I'm not BSing. She responded a month later, and we left in the middle of December to go to our friend's house, ATEMU's house, Rhythm's house, in Texas, since they were so kind to open up their hearts and space to let us stay there for half of a month when we finally got the apartment in January, which we took a road trip to get to, and it was actually a road trip. What happened on the way to Texas was essentially an escape from Illinois, because while there was options to stay there, ultimately I believe that at the end of this, the ultimate goal was to get to Oregon, so if I wasn't going to go then, I wasn't going to probably go for a while. I wanted to seize the opportunity, and I'm glad I did, because I've made more friends, I've gotten happier, and everything else. Anyways, back onto the texts. And I'm sorry this is so long, but this is very important. A month later, she says, I hope you are doing well. And, of course, I was in such shock I didn't know how to respond. So, jitters had helped me respond. Do not contact me unless you are ready to apologize for everything you did. Anything but will, Sorry, anything but will have you blocked. You said not to contact you ever again, and she did. Say that directly several times. You said I'm not your son. She said that several times. We have the recording to prove it. Goodbye. So, she responds, everything got blown way out of proportion. Yes, because yelling at us over food portions and artichoke is totally not out of proportion. And nor is the fact you yell at us or disown me as your son. That's totally not out of proportion. Fuck you. None of it had to go the way it did. I'm sorry on my side. It all went in attack from all involved. You do what you want. There's more than one at fault. And while I am sorry I did hurt, at the same time, there was no fucking justification for what the fucking bullshit that she did. I'm swearing too much, aren't I? I know I shouldn't be giving her this disrespect, but... Well, if you're gonna swear to me, cuss me out and everything all above, and make me feel like the worst possible person, I will gladly make you, Diane, feel how bad I did when you kicked me the fuck out. So, I responded. Unless, and again, did he help me write this? Unless you're ready to acknowledge the damage you caused to me mentally, that you were a mentally abusive, codependent parent, in which she was, and an alcoholic, do not contact me. Get therapy, get sober, get help, goodbye. Oh, but it does not just end there. Let's see about finding those spam messages. Let's see, spam filter. There we go, spam messages. Okay, these all occurred in the same day after. She responds, you all danged me mentally, withered the way attacks that were unnecessary and cruel. Goodbye, then. Of course, she would usually drunk in text when she was not... Oh, wait, she never didn't drink the box wine. And say, you don't see that. It's unbelievable. See you. And, of course, there was a multimedia message I missed and I never saw, probably for the better. Because if she was genuinely sorry... She wouldn't have just gone and said, okay, fine then, goodbye. Unless she was doing it just for herself. Or just to be right. If she was genuinely sorry, she would do what it took to make sure that she could get forgiveness. Because that's the type of person I am. When I mess up, I take it personally. Because when I screw up, I feel like I screw up the most worst possible way. Probably not the most healthy thing, given who I used to live with and was raised by. But I always tried to make sure that even if there wasn't forgiveness, there was closure. In this case, it wasn't so much closure for her as it was for me to know, okay, I guess the reason I feel the way I do in a lot of ways is because of her. The thing is, when it came to her, I always tried to impress her. I always tried to say, hey, look at the fabulous things I'm doing. Look what I'm doing online. Look what I'm doing here. Look what I can do. You know, the usual thing a kid would do for a parent, because they're like, as kids, we want to impress our parents. We want to be able to make them feel proud and feel proud for, you know, the proud circle. But the thing is, when it came to her, and sometimes my dad, sorry, Dad, when I would do something, I felt like the only response I got was more like a, I don't want to say cover love, but it's like, hey, I did this thing. Great job. You did awesome work. And they would always say they'll support me in everything I do. But it's like, I had friends to help me with this, and I'm not blaming you, Dad, for any of this, but it's like, when I'd produce something, I put passion into it. Diane, for a time, she saw this. Diane supported my passion because, well, I was passionate about this. I was passionate about art. I was passionate about editing. More passionate about videos like I used to be. As I used to be for a particular reason. I never felt like the two of you were able to share the passion that I had for a lot of what I did. So I'd constantly, after showing you something, feel less motivated to produce more of what I was showing. And like, even though you did say, great work and everything, I can understand that, hey, you're not in my area, or maybe you're not sharing my interest. I'm okay with that. And the only thing that I tried to explain later, since I couldn't explain it well, was that I was looking for someone to help me share a passion. Not just support, because I love support as much as it goes, but there's a point when I don't want to feel alone in sharing a passion. These videos, I used to have more passion for it a while ago, and I'm trying to get that back. Trust me, I really am. I really, really am. I was wanting to be very passionate in what I wanted to do. But when I would come forward with my passion saying, hey, I have this thing, I want to do this thing, I would get, oh, that's great, but compare, and they're saying this, not me, compare how you're doing to these other guys. It's like, well, you're looking to go into graphic design. Well, you have this, but look what you're going up against. I'm just playing devil's advocate, but you should go more for something that'll be good for you and give you benefits and help you in the long run. Sound advice. I understand. Of course, it's good to go into something, and of course, well, enjoy it as a bonus. And I turned out to be good at CNC, computer numerical control, which is basically manufacturing with a computer. And it might sound simple, but it's not for everybody, because there is some memorization and habits to get used to, and precision. Not for everyone, it's okay. And I did take the advice to, of course, well, make the money that's necessary, because how else would I support being here? And I'm working on that now. I understood that. I understood I had to make money. I had to make ends meet. I had to get benefits, because that's what I keep these things in my mouth. I never felt like there was a genuine sharing of passion for my parents. It's like, hey, I have this great thing. I'm feeling like I'm doing a great job. And then they would just say, yeah, you're doing a great job. They wouldn't ask, like, how I do it, or if they wanted to join in with it. Maybe add a couple suggestions, sure. But I would be the person to come to them for a lot of things. And me posting my videos online, that gets reposted to Twitter, which gets reposted to Facebook. And that's how family and friends see it. And that's usually how they see this. Again, I am not putting you down, Dad or Mom, for being supportive. It's just that I couldn't express this sooner because, well, with Diane, I didn't know how to. I would feel like I'm asking too much. I'm being egotistical. I'm like, hey, look how great I'm doing. And I'd be kind of thinking, in the back of their head, they're probably thinking something jealous or thinking, oh, no, you can't make it. And, Dad, I am sorry to call you out on this, but you had told me before that getting into acting and a lot of those places is just luck and opportunity. And you, Dad, you had said, you even expressed it to Diane, how much you wanted to go into acting and everything. And while you're doing great now, I'm not seeing a passion shared. Is that you want to do this and you say you don't have any time? I'm out of the house, and my little brother Tiberius, he's growing on his own. I understand you're helping, but and you're treating him as an adult, but you two are an adult, and I know you have a full-time job, but you've seen what I do here. I make time to do a lot of the bonus content. I don't want to say bonus content as much as it does sound like it, but you have a chance to produce something more than just what's in your life right now. You can just, hey, even do a YouTube channel like I've been doing for the past few years. I'm at over 3,400 something subscribers, but that didn't come without the work I put into it and trying to find things that worked. But I feel like when it comes to my channel, I've been falling short a lot of the time because with living with Diane and my dad, I was constantly, and not their fault, I was more hard on myself and very self-critical in all the fine details. Any time I'd flub a line or get something out incorrect, I'd think, oh, did I forget this one thing? I want to talk about this one thing a bit more. And like, oh, wait, what about this thing? What about that thing? It's like I can never feel like I'm satisfied with what I do. So while I was always producing a lot of Let's Plays every day, Let's Plays, of course, were the easiest thing for me to produce because it's recording with a personality that you eventually grow by doing this in repeatedly. You eventually grow a persona, but of course you start out, you record, get your content, which is then edited and then rendered in whatever editing software, and then posted with the title, description, there you go. Usually it's pretty easy. It's much easier to produce a lot of content more often when it's a Let's Play because it's very off the cuff. This is off the cuff, except for the script. So, what the thing is that I haven't produced a lot or edited a lot because I'm not satisfied with myself. I don't feel satisfied in producing content which people are telling me they love and like. To me, I'm very much someone who's nailing down all those little things and finding all the mistakes, all the errors, and afraid to put something together, put it out, because it's like, I put so much time as it is, and after so much stress, I don't want to put any more time in. And I shouldn't feel like that. This comes from living with Diane. My social anxiety disorder and clinical depression at this point, going to now, from her to now, things have just felt like they've ramped up. Like, I feel like I don't connect with the world anymore. I don't feel like I can connect. I don't feel a passion like I used to. I used to draw a lot. I wanted to draw a lot. I wanted to write a lot. I wanted to edit a lot. I wanted to do recording a lot. But I grew so afraid of doing everything. I feel like I was a disappointment to everyone that is like, if I did this, I'd be disappointing someone else for some other reason. I did this, but I didn't do that. I did this video, but I didn't do my friend's commission. I've been owing them for months. And of course, I would always say, hey, I'm busy. I'm taking time. I need the time. The thing is, I was always not explicitly depressed, but so uninterested in producing content that was sought after and loved, because when I did something, I was motivated because I loved doing it and because I knew there was love going into it and love coming out of it. But I was going through so much little positivity from Diane. Everything was negative, 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 negative. That all latched on. All those negative thoughts, I couldn't feel like I could do anything I wanted to do anymore. Doing all this, getting this far, having friends to help me, I never felt like it was worth it. Finding friends who keep believing I'm worth it when I don't is probably one of the best things I've probably had, but I feel like I'm too in myself to realize how much they matter, how much they care for me, and how much they're trying to help. I haven't done anything in a long time, art-wise, video-wise, because I feel like it's not worth it. Because I haven't felt like I am worth it. You saw me be positive, confident in everything. Thing is, I am usually a very much sensitive person. I care about people a lot. I cared about my mom to a point where I pretty much got my, what would have been a heartbreak from a horrible breakup. I'm sorry. I know I shouldn't be hateful. I know I shouldn't be angry, but I still feel like I should be. I have become an angry person who is very much not negative, but it's like you say something, I'll try and turn it a little bit just because I'm trying to find some sort of justification and feel like I got back at someone when I shouldn't have. Diane was the person I've been wanting to get back at for a long time because when she's always been wrong, I've always been the one to fix everything. I was always the one person that got it right. I was the smart kid. I was the guy who was always trying to make sure everything was good. Everything was great. We're going to be great. Yeah, that worked out. Didn't work out. So, a lot has gone on. I've lost a lot of passion. I'm trying to get that passion back. Because I need to. Trust me, I've fallen into such a deep depression that I was pretty much... I may as well have been getting drunk every day myself and decided I'm not worth it. Because why bother if people are going to be putting you down? Especially my your own mother. Again, I always tried to show my parents things because I wanted them to share my passion. I didn't realize that was what I wanted to do until after all this. I've realized, after having left Diane, all I really wanted was to not feel alone in passion. And when you feel alone after so long, you start to lose hope. And I've always been the person saying, hey, you're not alone. There is hope, and I'm hoping for you. And I want to do everything for you. When they finally came around to me, I felt like I wasn't really returning enough. Because when any time Diane gave me something, I would try and do everything I could to return it, but I never felt when I gave to her, I would get nothing. I was like, oh, a compliment. Thanks. Like, oh, you'll do great. You'll be awesome. You'll be this big thing. Vague compliments, vague motivations. Again, I don't place blame for not sharing the passion, but it's just that I never felt like my passion was sought after. It's like, hey, I show this thing. And then maybe someone would come up with a suggestion saying, hey, here's this great thing I saw online. Or, hey, they're doing this thing over at the school. You want to go into that? I maybe get maybe halfway there with certain things. It's like, okay, that's an option, or that's an option. What do you want to do? It's like, well, I had a passion. Passion wasn't given to me. Or, like, a shared interest. It's like, if you knew I wanted to go into acting as a parent of a teenager at the time that didn't have much of a resources, you would try and think, maybe I want to try and see how I can get my kid the most of their dream the best I can. Again, everything that came from this right here, art that's not mine, but example, getting to a point of having art maybe in a friend's room, I never exactly saw much of that. It's that, hey, you get a frame for your room, which is usually the case, yeah. It's just, I never felt passionate returned. I never felt passion returned. So, me going online, going on Tumblr, DeviantArt, for Affinity, YouTube, Twitter, Reddit, Facebook, I think I said, MySpace. I went to all these sites I could just so I could get myself known, not because I wanted to be known, but because I wanted to be able to entertain as many people as possible. I wanted to give a lot and see a lot of happiness brought back. Anytime I do any of this, you guys know I like to entertain. That's because I know you guys are genuinely entertained and you bring it back to me. I was trying to look for that within family and in an area that never really connected at the time, because at the time, I couldn't express myself correctly. Everything I do post online, while it is for notice and probably eventually a little bit more pay, because everyone who goes online, yeah, they want to be famous, they want to make money, they want to be rich and famous. The whole reason I would use or even try and get fame and fortune is to give it back and to share it. What I produce on here, everything's out of pocket and with the help of friends. This camera, I bet you didn't know, is actually a gift from ATEMU, the near and dear friend who got us over to Texas and drove the U-Haul while I drove my car so I could keep a car. And since my car couldn't handle a hitch and we couldn't spend the extra money to get my car on a hitch. Excuse me. A lot of what I do comes from me trying to put things out, and in return, I get help from friends, but I feel like because of Diane and in the area I used to live, when I produce something and something is given to me, I feel like I need to give 10 times back because it's like, oh my God, you shouldn't have done this. I should give this a lot back to you and share this with you. And I feel like what I give back is never enough. And you say, hey, here's a gift. I feel like I'm going to be expected to give a lot in return, or if I ask for help, I feel like I'll owe somebody a lot. And Diane was the type of person where when she gave you something, she would expect something in return. She would always expect things, or expect the world to be nice to her, forgive her, even if she was being mean or wrong. She was expecting me. In that message, that text, she was expecting me to apologize to her and come back to her, and we're at the point of no return. My friends and I are in Oregon. She disowned me. This is where we're at. With that, can you probably see why I don't feel like I have much passion when your own mother didn't give it to you? I would always expect something more than what you can give and always produce. No matter what she asked, I gave it. I went the extra mile. But because of that, I never quite went the extra mile in a lot of life things. Schooling, jobs, content. I always may as well damn near half-assed everything because I never felt it was worth my time. It was never right, and I had to do everything I could to impress someone else, but it's like, at that point, there's no passion. If you're doing something only to impress someone else, you're not doing it for yourself. You're not doing it for your passion. You're doing it for their interests. Diane, as much as she did support me, she had her own motives for what she did. Maybe beyond her control, because Diane, she has a narcissistic mother that was very much abusive to Diane and her siblings. Eileen, my grandma, as her name is. Eileen, she's the type of person where she would say, children are seen, not heard. And if you were heard, you'd get frickin' whipped, paddled, whatever else it took to make sure that you would shut up. Eileen also was the type of person to say one thing and then totally skip out. Example, in the old house in which you remember the old basement background in which I resided in a nice cool basement. With a broken central air unit, well, out of Freon, that we couldn't afford. Anyways, a few years ago, probably, no, it's not a few anymore, 2008, probably, Eileen had said, hey, I'm going to move in with you guys, family house. My mom's family, you know, Tiberius, myself, Diane, and then Eileen and her German shepherds from hell. Eileen had left an armoire, basically a big storage unit that would pretty much take up about half that, or not half, maybe, basically where my, oops, wrong way. About that far down, and have maybe only this much space above. I'm trying to do this for distance. Basically, I'm trying to give you an idea. Basically, a big, huge freaking thing that would block a window, which it did. And a couple other things are also left there, including a bed and a box spring, which Judas and I eventually used because Eileen ditched us to go move into her friend's house, who was trying to see about maybe going out with her, but of course she kept turning him down. So basically, our house was used as storage for Eileen. And eventually, while Eileen was going to be staying in Texas, coincidentally, at a different time, she skipped out on my aunt to go over to Arizona. Not a word. Left things there, not a word, went right over. That's the type of person Eileen is. And she's still at it, and she still thinks she's not wrong, and, well, she imprinted on Diane a lot. Basically, Eileen wouldn't care if her child cut their wrists, and if they died from it. Eileen, and Diane told me this, had said, well, she made her choice, and continued playing her organ loudly. Eileen, she was an organ nut and a realtor. Basically, she would play a loud organ in her house because, well, she liked playing an organ. But she didn't care that one of her children were going to probably commit suicide. That's the type of person Eileen was. And Diane had to deal with that for a long time. Diane is very much a lesser degree of what Eileen was, but because Eileen was who she was, a lot of it went on Diane, and Diane never felt happy with herself and would never be able to do all of what she wanted to do, and Diane was at a point where she would cycle the same thoughts and spiral down to negative, 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 and then blame the whole world on her and try and say it's all pushing it on her. Yeah, that was Diane because of Eileen. Diane is the way she is because of Eileen. I shouldn't blame Diane for what she did, but actions have consequences. And the consequences are, I'm not your son anymore until, Diane, you admit you can be wrong. You need help. Just because we say one thing does not mean we're out to get you and totally cast you out unless you are thinking of you being in that position. You putting yourself in that position and constantly saying, everyone's trying to push me out, push me to the side, make me be alone. If you were saying that to the people trying to help you, eventually that help does disappear and you need to fend for yourself. It got to that point. We're gone. And Diane, you need to help yourself. So, again, you can probably see where a lot of my passion had taken a nosedive. If it wasn't for me trying to help everyone else, I could probably be at a different position in life. But if I didn't make the decisions I did, I wouldn't be with who I am now, getting the help I am getting now. Maybe I didn't need the help. Maybe I didn't need the help on that other possibility. Who knows? But maybe if I hadn't gone through what I did, I wouldn't have met Jitters, met all his friends, gotten to an apartment in Oregon, now in my own space. All I mean is, I want to do great. I want to produce a lot. I want to do my best. But I feel like I never can, and I feel like I never have the will to, because I put so much of myself out. And I feel like when I get stuff coming back, it feels unnatural. It feels like it's ingenuine. It feels like someone's going to expect something in return. So it's like, hey, here's $500 to help you for the month since I know you don't have a job, but I know you're in debt, but please, take the $500. Yeah, I know you need help. And I'll usually say, well, wait a second. That's $500 frickin' dollars. And people can be generous, but it's like, I always ask, what can I do in return? Because that's just the person I am. I always try and ask, you give me a lot. How can I help you? And they usually say, don't worry about it. I've had friends who've been very generous and say, don't worry about it. And in the end, I'm very grateful, but I always feel like I want to give something back. And they always say, oh, just keep doing what you're doing. Just be happy, do what you enjoy, and produce more content. And that on its own, that's a good support. And I should see that as a positive thing. But part of me doesn't. It still doesn't. I know Diane and my dad, they would give me some gifts here and there, art-wise. I got a nice art set. I got pads of paper. I was grateful for that. It was plenty of content, but it's like, I mean, no offense since being seeming spoiled, but it's like, okay, he has an interest in this thing. How about we get to him this related thing? That's good, but maybe I probably should have said, hey, I'm leaning towards this. I eventually went digital. Sorry. But stuff like that. I would get, of course, some small gifts here and there, like little support. Support. It's good. But what I was looking for was passion. And now, seeing people trying to give me their passion or show their passion in me, so to speak. I mean, as a fan, a lot of you guys who are following me now, some of you are friends who have known me for a while. Some of you are coworkers, or maybe someone I met from maintenance. Seeing a lot of you being entertained by me or enjoying what I post, it's like, again, I'm very critical about how I do things or how I produce things. So I feel like, am I doing too little? Am I doing too much? Is this right? Is this too off of this area? Did I want to do this instead? That's very much how I've been thinking of things. Anytime I see you give me compliments and praise and everything, it's like, I'm thankful, yes. But it's like, I'm so used to a hollow response, it doesn't feel genuine as much as it might be genuine. If you're genuine with me, it's hard for me to feel anything that feels genuine. And I should probably refer to my script again since I have been going off my thoughts for the past hour. Let me just double check my script real quick. Yeah. Okay, I did speak about the passion. That's done. Remember this little checklist thing I'd usually do in the other videos? Yeah, it's kind of back. Yeah, I already spoke about doing a lot of my research myself because didn't feel like it was explored with me, so I explored for myself, felt alone. That's how it went. Okay. If you heard a small noise, that was my stomach. I haven't eaten. Yeah, fading into this part because I had to kind of recover a few things. Something I do want to say, though, to my dad, real quick. I want you to know, we have a better opportunity than ever to share our interests. And again, you can produce a channel right here and start right here. It doesn't have to be video. You can just use like a microphone, hook it up to your computer, and go. And maybe you want to make an audio play, maybe you want to talk about viral videos, who knows? But I hope I can get you to explore entertainment like you wanted to do. Like more like what you wanted to do. Sorry. I fumbled my words a little bit. But again, Dad, you told me you wanted to be an actor. You wanted to go into entertainment. I'm doing that right now. You could just all I have to do is put it in just a little extra time, even if it's just a video. If it's not community theater, and I can still go into community theater myself and probably use my weekends for that, you have an opportunity. I'm taking the opportunity. I want to show you that I can make something of what I'm producing. Because I wanted to show you how much passion I have for producing content. These videos, art, everything. I know you wanted me to get the paying job, get something that is able to last long term. I understand, I need a retirement plan, everything that goes with the adult life. But I want you to understand is that while I understand that, and you do support me, you have explicitly told me, and that you will support me no matter what I do, I only want to ask is that you share maybe some of the passion I have for doing this, and that I can be great with this, because if you put enough perseverance, determination, yeah. And, sorry, hard work. Like you want me to put for jobs. You can become something. Like, well, a famous actor. Sometimes it could be opportunity and luck. Sometimes. But it doesn't go without putting the work that it involves. For example, I got an opportunity to become the voice of the Doctor for he's an assistant in Ponies with Pockets, Ponies with Pockets Productions. Now, you see this character voice, I use a specific type of tone and oratory effects. The little David Tennant, it's kind of the inspiration, you can kind of guess here and there, yeah. But that was for me also trying to practice voice acting for a while. I kept practicing it. And hey, an opportunity came up when Keiko and Gilly, the former voice actor for Who's an Assistant's Doctor, had to step down. He had a lot of life stuff that came up, and I was around at the time at a convention, so I was saying, hey, here's my example of the Doctor. And wow, I'm losing my voice. I've been talking an hour. Probably why. So, took a bit of practice, agreement, understanding, and, well, I became the new voice of the Doctor. Well, second voice. It's hard to really explain in the story. But I keep trying to produce things. I haven't done a voice reel because motivation, again, and passion were on a low for a long time, and I'm wanting to use this video as a stepping stone to reinstill my passion in what I want to do. And what I want to do is entertain. That's the only thing I've wanted to do ultimately, is be able to make a living off of entertaining. The benefits might not be the best. I mean, you know, medical, dental, vision, life insurance, God forbid, and whatever else, but I can get that by having a day job. And that's what I'm trying to work towards. But it's like, well, you wanted me to get the day job, day job, day job, day job, day job. I never heard anything except unless I talked about it. I never heard anything about my passions and what I wanted to do unless I brought it up. Or unless I said, hey, look at this picture I drew. Hey, it's your best work yet. Dad, if you were following me for a while, or, well, if you showed the interest, or you wanted to follow where I was at, you could see the progress and see, oh, hey, look at this, maybe a suggestion, or, hey, you don't have to share my passion, but suggestions, even suggestions in, like, without me initiating something, something a bit more. I didn't know what I was looking for, but just, I want you, I'll be fair, I'll make this a lot nicer sounding. I want you to be able to see how I grow. I want you to, maybe, if you can, understand the process of how things work, how things look, maybe how this works. And who knows, if you find out how it works, maybe you might like it. He told me that about some jobs, like CNC. I'm good at being precise. All my friends tell me that. I'm very meticulous. But, yeah, I was trying to keep everything all in order. Since a lot of this is more me trying to find my passion again. And, sorry, I keep double-checking my script because I have to. So, Mom, I'm sorry if we hurt you, but you need more help than we can provide. I'm saying that again because I need to make sure she understands if she's seeing this video. And Dad, if you're seeing this video, I want you to, well, Mom, Dad, Stacy, Tyler, friends, fans, I'm trying to think of how to word this. I want you to understand. I want to do my best, but I have never, for a long time, felt like I can be motivated and keep a passion towards something. I'm not sure what it was. It could have been depression, who knows, but a lot of that came from being bullied for 8 years of my childhood. Not my parents, but school life before, you know, the whole let's stop bullying thing. I can't tell you how many times I went to days thinking, oh, I wonder who's going to make fun of me this time, or, oh, hey, who's going to be insulting me this time? That's a whole different story, but in short, that's why I tend to take a lot of things seriously, and that's why I tend to be sensitive, because when you're a kid trying to grow up and don't exactly understand a lot of differences and haven't made fun of, you start to take everything seriously, insult humor and everything. So it's like one little phrase can mean you're insulting me, and I know you don't mean that. And if I try and do it in return, I don't know how to do it. I didn't know how to do it most of the time, back then. I didn't know how to respond and give, like, I don't know, like a witty comeback. I'd always be nervous in what I had to say, because every little thing I said through from elementary school into high school would be scrutinized. Every little thing would be made fun of. Every little thing I did, action, word, it'd always be blowing up my face, would be make me be made fun of. And I don't want to toot my own horn, but I was usually the smart kid. I was the kid who was able to get things pretty quickly. And I don't want to do that to brag. I never mean to brag. I can't state enough how much I don't mean to brag. But I also want to be confident in my abilities. And I couldn't feel confident in my abilities because of a lot of my abilities being made fun of or put into question. I'd be the smart guy and everything. I'd get things done. And then it's like, okay, I'm doing great, but I'm getting a lot of negative response for it. Maybe if I become the class clown, I won't get it as badly. It helped a little bit. But because of that, that's probably why a lot of my focuses suffered a little bit. I mean, right now I should be really going into what I want to do. Producing content, editing, and, of course, taking breaks. Don't want to be a workaholic, but it's like, I can't even start to get motivated. I've been, like, through so much negative response that if I wanted to be motivated, I would have to force myself through some means. Sometimes it could be music. Sometimes it could be a good day. But it's like depression. It's like every other day, it's like, why bother? Because I had to deal with people that would constantly never give me a passionate, positive response other than a good job, you're doing good, I'm supporting you, yay. I'm not naming anyone in that matter, that's just being general, but it's like, when you feel like you're doing great things and you want to see the great thing reflected in the eyes of someone, and then when you want to hear the response, when it just turns out to be a good job or something else, it's like you just feel like you kind of like did all this work and just for like a little good job. And that does come with a lot of things, but when it came from those who are close to you or who you wanted to get close to, it didn't feel like it was worth it. Like you could just, at that point, you may as well just coast and half-ass. A lot of what I did is pretty much, I just kind of decided, well, if I do just enough, I'll make him somewhat satisfied, because at that point, I wasn't doing it so much for me as I was for them. Schooling and everything else, I was getting scared of, well, going into it and what I get out of it, but it's like, I was being told, you have to get something good, I want to make sure you have a good life. I was trying to respond, but at that time, being unable to communicate and going through everything else, I was in such a closed-off panic, I was like, I don't know. And I don't know wasn't good enough, and I took everything, positive or negative, to heart, because I took everything very literally. I couldn't understand otherwise. So, I'm trying to really reconnect myself with this video and everything else. If you follow me on Tumblr, on jester.tumblr.com, I did that the wrong direction, whatever. I have been blog hopping a little bit, I guess you can probably see. I've been producing content where I can, but I'm at a point where I've been so demotivated from Ask Mad Doctor Hooves and Bubbleberry Answers. I still have like artists who are waiting with images they produced to go on the blog, but I have an in-between segment I need to produce, which is a important development post. I'm busy right now. I know that I have to do a few other things right now, but before this, I couldn't find the motivation to produce just about anything. I was so much into trying to get a lot of my creatures and stories out in Ask Mad Doctor Who's because I have at least like 20 different story arcs and like a ton of creatures I want to show. But again, while passion and likes were given, or sorry, while a lot of good jobs were given and everything, and I did find friends, the passion, no offense, came too late. And it's taken me this long to finally get back on my feet again. It's taken me months, if not a few years, a couple years maybe, to get to this point where I can actually feel like, hey, I'm actually able to feel other people around me being genuine about sharing passion. When you live with someone who's always expecting something other than what you can give, or expecting the extra mile, or expecting everything at a given time, it becomes work and less like passion. It becomes hollow and barely worth the time. When I wanted to do something, if I started it, I'd get interrupted, not like in a bad way, but because other things had to get done. It's like anything I would try and create, I would feel paranoid looking over my shoulder because I would always expect some kind of judgment response, or I would expect reassurance because I never got the passion. I had to feel like I was being reassured because I would always get half responses, negative responses, somewhat positive responses. I'd always say, does this look good? Does this seem all right? Am I saying the right things? Is this not too much? Are you sure I shouldn't add something else? I may as well have been codependent myself at that point because of Diane being codependent on me, trying to help her be her therapist after a while. So, I don't not produce things because I. Let me make sure I got those negatives correct. It's not that I don't, I'm not producing things because I don't necessarily want to, but because I can't feel like I want to, if that makes sense. A lot of what I did was very much psyching myself up to do a lot of things because I was trying to do things in the long run, and it's like after a while I kept getting I got tired because I was doing too much at a time. And I was doing too much that I could take on and feel like I could do it. I couldn't do a lot of things that I've promised because I feel like I'll never meet as someone's expectations. Because someone's always expecting something. Diane, you were always expecting something. And even if someone wasn't there to be on your in your corner, you made them get in your corner. You called me a traitor for not being in yours. I'm trying not to be codependent and understand I can make mistakes. That allows me to grow. I can't be perfect all the time, as much as I want to make sure things are perfect the first time. That's just who I grew to be. I don't always have to be perfect. I can make mistakes. I could say a wrong thing and go, oh, sorry. I'm genuinely sorry. But to feel happy, I haven't had that in a long time. I used to be this really high-energy, happy-go-lucky guy at conventions that would usually be that bouncy character in costume, and I did that a few times. But over time, that energy just decided to calm down, not because it was getting calm, but because a lot of positivity decided to go the other way. And I would just be barely making enough, and I'd feel like I'd only be in it for myself. And at a point, I was doing things because I felt like no one else could share what I wanted to get into. No one else could share my passion. No one else knew what I was meaning. No one else would be able to share this like I would want to share with them. What if they decided to try and do something to just laze out, or I say laze out because I mean be lazy. Like, what if they decided to be eventually just lazy, or if they tried to overtake what I did and tried to do something else? I get paranoid. And I've been paranoid for a long time about a lot of things. Because I had to be in that mindset of paranoia, because I would always be able to expect and meet the extra mile. I did that for Diane. I always thought ahead, because if I didn't think ahead, if I didn't know I was asked, I'd be yelled at, punished, and everything else into my 20s. Diane tried to treat me like an adult, but said she wanted to treat me like an adult, but she wouldn't. My dad, you tried to treat me like an adult, and you did. Because you were being the one who was more real world and sensical. But the thing is, my parents are divorced, if you hadn't guessed throughout all this. Or if you didn't know that now, now you do. The exact things that led me to the point of leaving, thankfully able to keep my stuff, as you can see being unpacked still, things that got me to this point got my dad to the point where he did the same thing, but at that time, he just left with the clothes on his back. Diane's actions got my dad to stop being with her. And my dad, well, he had some growing up to do too. He was in his, let's see, he was about 35 at the time. So, out of his 20s, where I am now. Funny enough, this is the age that I was, no wait, 25, I'll just make it simple. 25 was the age my dad had me. Well, my mom had me, whatever. I'm probably not going to do children. Not because, again, I don't want to. I might adopt one day. Who knows? And yeah, it's a case of who knows, but I want it to be understood. I want to pursue a passion. And if you're saying, like, okay, you need to do this first, where do I come in? Basically, that's what I ended up saying. So, there was a lot of expectations put on me that I never felt like I could speak up against, because if I did, that was how I lived, and that's why I'd lost a lot of passion. So, I keep seeming like I'm going to close this out, but this has been a lot that's been in my head for a long time. It's a long video, but I hope you've understood that I'm a person who's just been scared for a long time to do anything and do it well, and not do what I want to do. I can do a lot of things. I can do a lot of great things. So can anyone. And I can do a lot to provide for myself. But if you're just trying to get me cut and dry to be the robot at work, I'll become that type of person. I don't want to be a robot, though. You tell me to work at this place, but don't exactly help me plan out what I really want to do. It's like saying, work at this place until you're gray. It's not like saying, work at this place, but when you're doing that, you can be doing this and taking classes for maybe that or this. When I say that, I don't mean the art that time. I mean like a job. It's just that I don't want to be made to feel like I have to stay somewhere because I need to, compared to what I want to do. Because if you're saying to only focus on the need, there will never be a want. And basically, the needs will just be cut, dry template. Just a cut, dry template that I have to just fit into every day. Go out, do it, come back. I know. I have things I need to do. But there are things I still want to do. And if you can just acknowledge and discuss with me more about the things I want to do, my passion will be that much more bolstered. But if you say, yeah, you can do that in the meantime, but then talk 20 minutes about this, which may have been stated before. If you talk 20 minutes about the job, instead, it's like saying, okay, that's great, but you need to do this. That's the real world, as I've been told. It's like, yeah, you want to do that? Sure, if you want to not keep a job. I know the real world is very harsh. The real world requires you to make money. It requires you to have a job. But if you could just listen to me for whatever length of time, and then just genuinely share your time with me, if not the passion, just share a discussion with me. Just let me know that you listened, you heard me. If you could just let me know, if you could just listen and share what I'm talking about with me, even for that time, I would feel that much more confident. If you're gonna say, if you're gonna be like, again, spend 5 minutes on what I'm talking about, but then spend 20 minutes on something else that's not your passion, but something that says, hey, you need to do this, I'll be like, sure, I know, but it's like, when do you stop to ask if I understand? And when do you stop so that you can check if we can go into this together? Of course, it's good to do things on your own. And it's great if you can do things on your own, but it's pretty lonesome and pretty scary on its own, so it's not the most comfortable feeling. But again, I never felt like I could ask for help because I felt like it's not worth it. Saying I'll be asking in return. I'm asking too much, asking too little. I'm annoying someone. That was a lot of what I had to deal with Diane. And with Dad, one more time. I know you want the best for me. You want me to be realistic. But at the time, I was too afraid to say anything more than just a few words or anything just to satisfy you because I always had to satisfy Diane's expectations. And you were expecting a lot of me, and I was trying to do that, but it's like feeding two expectations of two different people, but never having any of myself to give myself any expectations because I'd be bouncing back and forth between two different stories, arguments, and ideas of what to do. Do this, do that, do this, do that. I'm using my hands as symbols saying opposites constantly pulling me back and forth. I couldn't talk because I was afraid to. And because I was told, let it be, let it sit over there. And then I just had to take the days as they went. That was very empty, cold life. And I didn't know otherwise. I couldn't tell the difference. I've met lots of friends along the way up to Oregon, and online I've realized I have more friends than I think I have. Because when you're not motivated and you don't get a lot of positivity, you don't always think maybe people actually are genuine. Maybe it's just face value. I would feel disconnected. I would just be disconnected and say, thanks. And this would be my response after. It's like, hey, how you doing? And that kind of instantly seem happy and everything. But internally, I'd be like this. Uninterested, not passionate, unmotivated. Because when people asked for motivation, I just gave a simple answer just to get by because I didn't want to upset anybody. Because I was too afraid to make a sound. So, thanks, Eileen. Yeah. Parental abuse goes a long way. And abusers don't know that they're being abusive. And those who aren't abusive but have been abused will have their own views on things and try to help them how they can because that's how they know. That's what they know. Being abused is a very heavy thing to live through. What I went through was a lot of, well, trauma. For what I didn't realize was trauma and wore me down mentally and emotionally and physically. I mean, you probably see the wrinkles on my head. That's a lot of stress. I look like I'm 40 and I'm 25. Stress and abuse can go a long way. But if you can find that little glimmer of something to help, please grab onto something that you can. Grab onto the hand in front of you and just take the help when you know it's a friend. And they tell you it's a friend. Please just understand, you can take a hand for help. You might feel they're wrong, but you don't feel your abuser may have been wrong. It works that same way. You get told one thing, you believe it. And you get it enough times, for a long enough time, you'll believe it. If you are abused and you are trying to help your abuser, I did that too. It's not just a boyfriend or girlfriend or anything like that outside of family. Family's involved with it too. So, just, if you see a chance in the long run, you can weigh the differences, pros and cons. If you see an opportunity that can be great in the long run, even if it's scary, it might be worth taking. But don't be afraid to say something. I'm a voice actor for that kind of purpose. Actually, the voices help me talk. Because I use dramatic voices like these. Sorry. I'm not in the most confident position at the moment. But some things happen, and they won't be the best. But believe friends who are there to help and show they can help and show how they've helped. You can be helped. So can I. I'm still working on it. I had a point in there somewhere. I'm trying to remember what it was. Oh, well, I wanted to say what the positive thing was. Outside of the escape from Illinois down to Texas, where my friends were, to let us stay for half of a month. It was nice seeing a view going down there, and then when we finally got the apartments, got the Renter's insurance, blah, blah, blah. We made our road trip. It actually was a road trip. It went from Texas to Santa Fe, New Mexico. Well, we had to make a stop in Amarillo, Texas. Nice hotel. It was pretty nice. Nice little corner room. Mind you, this road trip hadn't have worked out if not for the help of the friends and fans who had helped in the first place on the GoFundMe and the donation drives that we have had. We had in between. Oh, on the note of GoFundMe, Diane has changed the description on the GoFundMe page, if you find her GoFundMe. The description, if it's still up, had to explain how we, the four of us, myself, Jitters, Sin, and Enzi, how the four of us betrayed her and caused her to be put out in the street and everything else. Well, not explicitly put out in the street, but basically she was blaming us for everything and how everything wrong we did was on us, or everything that went wrong was on us. She called us out publicly on a GoFundMe page and then did it on Facebook, where I promptly said, hey, here's what happened. Here's are the things that she left out, and here's the links to the videos and audio recordings. Well, not videos, more audio recordings. And pretty much she was trying to leave out what she could to be right. If she's not wrong, she may not be wrong, but she's always right. Yeah, it's like every time I came forward to her with something, calling her out and stuff, it's like, I was false about that, and she had talked to Tiberius about that, and it turned out that even if Tyler didn't remember it, it was false, even if I remembered it. And anything I did to help, she said, you didn't have to do that. So it's like, great, so all the times I helped you, you are admitting you were ungrateful. Diane was ungrateful. Anyways, back to the road trip. Went to Amarillo, Santa Fe, New Mexico, Arizona, for a little bit of something. I remember, and Arizona didn't really have too much. Oh, yeah. And we did have a good thing, a really nice bed and breakfast over in Arizona. So, after the nice bed and breakfast and a little bit of trying to find the inn, we eventually went over to Las Vegas, where we didn't gamble, but we stayed at the, what's the biggest hotel there? I don't know, it's the big white hotel that's in the middle of everything near, across from Treasure Island, the Trump Tower that's gold-plated because he's greedy. Right. Anyways, at the hotel we stayed at, we actually were treated very well by a great friend of ours over there as well. Really nice apartment with, or not, it felt like an apartment, a really nice room and a VIP dinner. Basically, it was the biggest hotel. The Palazzo. That's what it was. The Palazzo. We had a cocktail hour, which was actually a few hours. And saw a lot of upper-class people there, and, well, it felt a little awkward being the middle-class folks among the people who kept talking about golf. But we enjoyed that. Got a bit drunk since it was on the house. But when we went from there, went up to Reno, again, didn't gamble, nice little room, and then we went up to, let's see, make sure I got that correctly, it was Reno, got through California, and I missed a day. But then we stopped in Newport, really nice area, beautiful beach house, and we were near home free. You know, I should probably mention we were at a lot of nice restaurants and everything else, but that's besides the point. We were able to actually share a lot of great experiences along the way. We made a lot of tourist visits in different areas in the States. You can probably guess a few, but Ultimately, it's been a chance to open up myself, reassess myself, and learn and grow. Of course, it seems like I might have gotten a little bit of a boost from friends, but that's because my friends were there to genuinely help, and we were ultimately doing this because it's a great experience to be shared with everyone, because my friends and I, we know now that it's to be shared, and when something is a gift, it doesn't have to mean there's an expectation for something to come back. I have genuine friends now, and that's something I'm very thankful for. So, with all these positive reinforcements and everything else, it's taken me a long time to get out of my disconnection with reality and people. I've been a nervous person for a long time. So anytime I do these videos, I've usually always been nervous and expecting something else or missing the mark. And I never been able to really possibly meet that exact amount of genuine wit I wanted to provide. Because my name is Jester. I'm kind of wanting to be a bit of a funny guy sometimes. I wanted to be something greater than what I was. I wanted to be something greater than what was expected of me to otherwise be. I wanted to be loved for the passion I provide, not just because of what I can do, but because of what I've done. Well, I guess also what I can do. I wanted to just be loved and just appreciated for what I can do and what I have done. And not have to feel paranoid on not being enough. Because enough was never enough in where I used to live. So being able to genuinely feel any emotion, I forgot to add that way at the beginning. I had to act in a mirror for the longest time. So I'd always try and come up with all the faces and try and look at the camera and try and always find the right face that would always put people in the right setting and always come up with a voice that seemed so perfect for the right situation. My social anxiety kind of was a part of that, and I'd always be rehearsing all the different things in my head of what could go on. I could never live in a moment because I was always too afraid to. Because I was always made fun of. I was very much made fun of for anything I did in a moment. I couldn't just be in a moment and go like, okay, I did the silly thing, and it's like, after the fact, you'd be so embarrassed about it, I wouldn't want to talk about it. I couldn't just think, yeah, I was a goofball. I couldn't feel that way because I couldn't. So, I guess I can probably go back to Undertale for this outro a little bit. Undertale came at a perfect time when I was in very much a bad situation. I was playing Undertale around the time this whole thing had been going on. The abuse, or not realizing abuse, abuse, not realizing I was abused, not being able to feel certain emotions. Those of you who have played further in Undertale, you know what I'm talking about not being able to feel certain things. It was nothing but just me being determined to get what I would hope would be eventually the best of me, or really, I just wanted to win. I just wanted to feel like I won something. I'd always be the guy in the back of the line, or I'd always be the person in the group that was, well, the bottom. The one who was a slacker, the one who was, well, basically, I wasn't able to. I wasn't able to feel like I could win. Because I was always put in a situation where someone else would win. and I never felt positive, and I got competitive. And I got competitive to a point where that added on to my lack of passion. The competitiveness I had gotten me so ramped up that, again, I lost passion, and I felt like I always had to win. And when I never won, motivation, passion kept falling. So if I was able to just succeed at one thing, just win something great for once, I would feel probably vindicated and maybe not be alone in feeling something great out of it. Again, those of you who've played Undertale might know who I can probably relate to at this point, but I'm trying to be able to come into feeling everything again. I want to be able to genuinely produce happiness on camera and everything else, not just have it acted out and exaggerated. And I know I didn't really do a lot of what I did without probably hurting a few people along the way. And if there was anyone I hurt for being who I was these past years online, I'm genuinely sorry if I hurt you. I didn't mean to be that way, but in my state of mind, I felt justified. And I would try and do whatever I could, if I screwed up, to try and make things right, but I'd probably make it worse in the process. Again, I'm genuinely sorry if I hurt anyone, but maybe a lot of what I did was because I felt like I never won, and I was always the guy who had to follow everyone else. And ultimately, I always lost in the process, so why bother if you're gonna lose? Why bother if you never win? And now, when I say I want to win and succeed, it's not for the merit of winning and succeeding. It's to be able to win the feeling of genuinely feeling like I succeeded. Any success I had felt like it was just a piece of paper I would just wave around saying, "Hey, look at my resume. Look at all the things I did. Hey, you want me to do this thing? I can. Let me just act it out. Give me a while and some confidence. I can eventually get this resume to be a bit longer if you let me do this thing." And so I just coast, do what needs to be done with it. But I don't want to feel that way. I want to be better. I will be better. And I know with this long video, you can as well. You can be, again, it's Jesus saying this, you can be anything you want to be. Just be, of course, wise about it, and just go for it. Doing this, I'm still going for videos. I'm still wanting to be an entertainer. That's what I'm trying to do right now. And a lot of you share that passion. CEPHAS, I've seen you produce these videos, these types of videos, saying how much you want to do this, and I admire your passion into going into acting. A lot of my acting has just been a lot of self-training and a musical in high school. That was about it. But I want to be able to feel like I can genuinely share passions without feeling angry because I never was able to feel validated. Genuinely validated. We can do great things. We just have to be able to put our mind to it and have the friends there to help and those to be with us who will genuinely help us and be there for us, not just with us. Because being for someone is different than being with them. If you're for being with someone, that means you want to be with them. You want to maybe share a lot of what they have, which is great. But if you just want to be with them, to be with them, that's on its own hollow. I couldn't think of the right words, but probably because I'm hungry. If you're there to be with someone, just to be with someone and ride the coattails, that's pretty much being narcissistic. I've had to deal with a few of those people. Just climbing in a ladder. If you're a ladder climber, please realize this, there, what you go through isn't just to win. There are people who are willingly help you. There are people willing to help you if you are willing to be a person and work with them. If you're just gonna try and climb the status for who knows what whatever means, that will hurt you very much in the process. If you're doing it to get back maybe at an abuser, I can see why, but that's almost where I was starting to head to, because I was jealous of Markiplier, PewDiePie, and all those other guys, Jack, Septiceye, name dropping. Go figure. And I'm not doing that just because I can't, but they're the first names that popped in my head because they're the heavy hitters. I get competitive and didn't have an interest in thinking, wait, I can cooperate with these people. I never saw cooperation as much as I saw the word competition. Because I felt like I had to succeed and be the best for my parents and friends so I can say, hey, you have all this great thing, you have all these great things you can do. Here's a great thing I can do. I never felt like I actually had anything great I was great at. So, you can be great. And everything said and done. Things will be better. I'll be better. So will you. Just don't be afraid. Easier said than done, right? So, once more, I'm Yesterday Rama. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night. See you next time. Love you. Sorry, did I forget something? Oh, hey! Oh, yeah. What was that again?
Praise the Spurple!
Okay, now it's the end of the video. Later.